eSquared is for encourage and equip, and that's our goal today, is that you would leave here with a little bit of encouragement and equipped to serve where you are during these amazing and challenging times. We're going to move right ahead to our opening segment. Since our last gathering, America and its focus has changed quite a bit. The violent murder of George Floyd in Northern California has triggered a response from coast to coast, including, as we all know, protests and gatherings and riots, and still Black Americans dying at the hand of police continues. So the question is, how do we as church leaders respond? What does a faith-based respond to social unrest look like? And I'll just say that's a phrase I borrowed from one of our presenters, an individual who served here in Southern California for a long, long time. First, Dr. Dewayne Winrow has served for 45 years as the minister, the preacher at the Reseda Church of Christ. His leadership in the community and his work in racial reconciliation has made him a trusted Christian voice all over Los Angeles. And talking before, Dewayne reminded me that he worked with Marshall Keeble. I mean, he goes a long way back in our Church of Christ roots. Dr. Winrow, thank you for being here. Just quickly, how many kids are in the Winrow household as far as how many children do you have?
I have four children, but none of them are here.
all grown up and out.
All grown and gone.
And Reseda is still in online services, correct?
That is correct.
All right.
No consideration of going out until we know it is safe for our membership.
Amen. Amen. All right. And also then we've got Pastor Fate Hagood. Fate is a regular speaker at Harbor Bible Lectures, has served as the minister of the Metropolitan Church of Christ in Carson. Now, he said for 20 years, maybe I got that wrong. I didn't think Fate was old enough to have done that, but maybe so. His congregation's been a leader in racial reconciliation in the South Bay area. I count Fate as a good friend and grateful to have him with us today. Fate, how are you doing?
Glad to be here. Absolutely.
And tell me about the kids in the Hagood house.
Oh man, I'm excited. My oldest, I have two children. My oldest, Destiny, she is just an amazing Christian young woman. She is entrepreneurial. She has started her own business.
Oh my goodness!
And she works in the business. You know, she works in show business behind the scenes. So
wow,
I'm really excited for her. My son, Faith the Fourth, lives in the Bay Area now. Married to beautiful young lady named Nicole. They have one child, Faith the Fifth.
Oh, my word. Now, will he be called Quint? I mean, you know, what do you do?
They call him Cinco.
Oh, okay. All right. All right. Cool. Well, let me get right into the discussion here. I know that Los Angeles has been in the news. In fact, I heard Dr. Winrow the other day on, I forget whether it wasn't KTLA, it was one of the 1070 radio, speaking at a gathering with regard to the justice issues that we're dealing with, not just within our city, but also all across America. So, Dr. Winrow, I'm going to lead off with you. How's your ministry there in Reseda been impacted by the events of the last 2 months? And if you will, what has your time in Southern California taught you about dealing with racial reconciliation, what we need to hear right now, and as you say, a faith-based response to social unrest? Dewayne?
The first thing that I would say in terms of my experience, you know, historically in Southern California is to know that when we talk about systemic racism, it is real, it is alive and well. And so what we're seeing in terms of the outcry in the streets, we talk about what happened with George Floyd. That's not an event. That's a historical continuum, you know, but all of this has led us to a moment in time that I think is very significant, a time of reckoning, a time that it seems like the culture at large have come to the realization that something is fundamentally wrong. Now, when we talk about, let me just say about, you know, this thing of systemic racism. Any one of us, you know, who have been in the community for some time would know firsthand that we're not talking about anything academically. We're talking about something that we experienced. When I came to Pacoma, I'll just share a couple of experiences. I was a young man of 22 years old, preaching for the what then was the Vaughn Street Church of Christ, coming from one night, coming from a Bible study class, passing through the project area, getting going toward home, found myself being followed, you know, by police, followed me all the way, you know, to my home street, my house, the street my house was on. Soon as I turned onto my street, the police moved in front of me, did not pull me over, just cut me off, got out of their cars with guns blazing, you know, ordered me out of the car, you know, with guns in my face, handcuffed me. My wife was trying to get out of the car per their orders, and then they called her a B word and told her to get back in the car. Then they searched me, found out, you know, from taking my wallet out, you know, that I was a minister, you know, and all of a sudden they started backing up, and they wrote me a ticket as a cover up saying that I was speeding, you know, while they followed me almost 2 miles, you know, but they said I was. So that was just one incident. This took place in front of my neighbors. Of course, when we went to court on it, they didn't show up. You know, the other incident, you know, that occurred, you know, in my life, you know, my wife and I left home early one Saturday morning. When we got back, we found that our entire block had been roped off, police cars everywhere, SWAT, you know, was on the street, and my neighbors began to tell me that they're at your house. They actually raided my house, you know, said they were looking for drugs. No. They said that somebody had made a phone call. They didn't know what actually house it was. And so, you know, they thought the person could have been hiding in the closet or whatever, you know, but my daughter was in the house. You know, she was left there alone. She was on her cell phone calling 911, you know, saying that the police was outside trying to give her orders. She felt that they had the wrong house or whatever, but the operator told her, just do whatever tell you to do. And they ordered her out of the house, walking backwards, you know, that type of thing. You know, that occurred with me. Third item, you know, same situation. My son was followed home by the police. And when he got home, he came in the house. I was exercising, you know, not fully dressed. He told me that, you know, he think the police, you know, had followed him. And also there was a helicopter up above. And so I went out to look out, and I found police, you know, ordering me out of my house, telling me to come out. You know, they were motioning to me to come out. And so I stepped out of my house, and then they pulled me and my son into the middle of the street, handcuffed us in front of our neighbors, you know, and then another police car came up, you know, shining lights on us with somebody evidently in the back seat supposed to be identifying us, you know, as some hijackers or whatever, you know, that occurred, you know, with me. In other words, being pulled, dragged out of my house. Never would happen if I was in another neighborhood. So I'm saying this type of stuff, and I can go on in terms of personal experiences, you know, with this policing and this racist culture of policing, you know, which we are addressing in our, but the time has come. And I think that God has created the moment through what is occurring and things that have been captured, especially through video, that people have come to the point, you know, where at least Black people has come to the point where we can unapologetically, that's why I say when we talk about what time it is, you know, for the first time, I think in this nation, Blacks can unapologetically say that we're frustrated, we're angry, we're hurting. And for the first time, I think in the history of this country, whites can unapologetically say, look, I'm ignorant, or maybe even complicit with this problem. You know, and for all the hurt and the pain that have gone on at this moment, there is a silver lining. And the silver lining that we have the opportunity to have open conversations such as this, you know, to talk about that thing that is called white privilege. You can't move from prejudice, personal prejudice, to racism without talking about the bridge to that, you know, because prejudice is a personal phenomenon. Racism is a social phenomenon. But the bridge to that is this thing called white privilege. And now we can have open conversations about this phenomena, a conversation that usually would take place behind closed doors without mixed company for the fear of offense. And the beauty of the moment is being able to discuss how people can have that privilege and be totally oblivious to being empowered by it. And so I think this is a very precious, I don't want to take up, you know, the time here, but I just want to set the setting, you know, for what we're talking about from a from a faith-based perspective, I think when you look at the text that we're supposed to be dealing with, you know, which is Second Corinthians 5:18 and following, talking about the ministry of reconciliation, the first phrase in that passage is significant because it says all things are of God. And that sets the basic scope of what the ministry and calling of the church is supposed to be. But we have to realize, and what history have showed me about the church, that the church has little to no social consciousness. We don't have a social ethic. Actually, I wrote my dissertation on why we don't have a social ethic in churches of Christ.
I was going to say, Dr. Winrow, what is the answer to that question? Why do you think that social ethic is missing?
Well, and I tell you why. One, there's an academic reason for that. Number one is when you look at how the restoration motif was shaped in the crucible of the Enlightenment with the secular and sacred divide, it resulted in a restoration motif being a religious vision as opposed to a prophetic social vision. In other words, we don't see our calling, you know, globally in terms of what God is doing in the world and paying attention to the movements of God and harmonizing our ministry and step with what God is doing globally, you know, and therefore understanding the calling and role of the church within that context. You know, because we were caught up initially in this divide from the secular and sacred divide where we don't see all of reality as sacred, you know, then we confined our concerns and confined our mission to the private sector of, you allow me to say private sector, but the what we consider the sacred. So yes. Our mission then of reconciliation actually becomes a religious mission. No, we're reconciling churches, reconciling denominations. The church is going to have to pivot. You know, if we're going to recognize and be relevant in this world, the church has got to realize that it has a community-centric mission, you know, a community-centric message, where the Bible says God has given us the ministry of reconciliation and the word of reconciliation. It's a ministry that was accomplished by Christ and then given to the body of Christ, you know, on earth. And in order for us to fulfill that mission, then we have to recognize what God is doing in the world. Yes. And apply that principle, the ministry of reconciliation and the principles of reconciliation and the message of reconciliation to the movements of God. Because let me just say this and I'll turn it over, you know, to Faith. But the point is, historically, change takes place in this world through historical movements of God. Four in particular. Mm-hmm. In other words, historical change takes place through four phenomena. Number one, war. Number two, economic downturn. Mm-hmm. Number three, mass social movements of outrage. Mm-hmm. And then number four, pandemics. If you recognize, it's easy to see that three of those phenomena exist all at the same time, at the time that we're living in. Yeah. How God changes the world, three of those four phenomena are in existence right now. And we have to be ready and capable of seizing the moment.
Amen. And amen.
That's the holy
perfect storm that we're in the midst of.
Yes, perfect storm.
Right now, Faith. Let me ask you this question. When I grew up in the churches of Christ, social issues were way over here, and religious issues were over here. And we just talked about the religious issues. Was that the same where you grew up? And how would you respond to this question about a faith-based response to what's going on, brother?
Well, first of all, ditto to everything Dr. Winrow said. The first part of your question, when I was growing up, that was not my particular experience in the church, but I think that was peculiar to Dr. Hogan, and those who are in his line of thought. We were always involved in those type of things. I can remember one time, I forget the year, but the idea of social justice, but also the spiritual, were always intermingled with Dr. Hogan. But I don't know if he saw it as community. I think he more saw it as a necessity of the sacred, meaning that he would constantly call people who were in churches of Christ who were racist. He would say that those policies and those ideas were racist policies. He would literally question their salvation. How can you be a Christian and treat another person like this? How can you say you are saved and treat another person like that? And so that was more my experience growing up. When you talk about a sacred response, I think the ministry of reconciliation is the nature of the church. So what we have done is we've tried to be a platform for conversations for people to talk. And I've gotten pushback from even some of my contemporaries on this, but I do believe that the church needs to be a place where everybody can talk. If there's any place where we can bring everybody together, it ought to be the church. And so about 4 years ago now, we had this thing called Black Sunday. And we brought together people from Black Lives Matter. We brought together people from the judicial system, had a judge there. We had policemen there, and we had a preacher there to kind of speak so that everyone can speak. And that's my picture of, I don't think we can do anything if we don't talk to each other. I don't think we can have reconciliation without conversation. So we've got to talk to each other. And I don't believe that is a matter of being disingenuous. I just think if a person is never heard, they can nod their heads and say, yeah, and all that stuff when you're in your presence. But as soon as they go out of your presence, it's that second meeting. That second meeting when they really say what they wanted to say. I think they need the environments where people can say what they really want to say. Even if people are racist, I think they need to be able to say it openly so that their racism can be confronted. You talked about the idea of systemic racism. Because of how I grew up, a majority of my systemic racism I've experienced within the church context.
Wow.
Because in my, in my teen years, my life pivoted from being more of a street kid to be more of a church kid. Most of my formative years were in the system of Churches of Christ, and we call it National Youth Conference, State Youth Conference. That was my community. And I was a singer, and so I was going everywhere singing. And where I experienced the most racism was in the church. How my brothers who happened to be white would receive me. I still remember we were at a church. I won't say where it is because I don't want to out anybody. but it was here in Southern California. And had a group called Covenant there. We were kind of like a semi-professional group. We would sing sometime. We sung all over. Anyway, they had us come and sing this white church. And we were just doing what we do. Suddenly, the preacher of the church came in the back. We were in the front on the stage. The doors to the sanctuary were in the back. So he comes from the back and he's walking up to the front and he's dancing like he's in a minstrel show. And I'm not gonna kid you. I wanted to jump off the stage and knock him out. I mean, I wasn't a street kid, but I hadn't been that far removed from the street. I'm just being real.
Tell it, brother. Tell it.
I didn't, but I was furious with him. But those are the kind of things that I've experienced relationally within Churches of Christ. Now, when you talk about my experiences otherwise, I don't think you can find a black man who has not had at least 5 or 6 inappropriate interactions with policemen. At least not in my experience. I mean, I've been handcuffed, followed, the whole nine. And I've literally never been in trouble with the police, ever. But for some reason, I have all these experiences.
And Faith, you know what strikes me? Because ignorance. I just need a label on the top of my head. I have been close to brothers and sisters in black congregations here in Southern California for 40 years and, sure, and in North Carolina. But if you don't ask, if you don't say, hey, you know, tell me about your experiences, it's just not something, and you put it well, people want to talk about. I so appreciate you and Dr. Winrow personally saying, hey, this is something that's happened to us, because there are still jaws that are dropping when those stories are told. I've talked to 3 different ministers in the last 2 weeks who told me similar stories, and each time I was like, no way. And they were like, yeah, where have you been?
Let me give you an example. Back in the day when I was doing a lot of youth ministry, when you were doing a lot of youth ministry, and we would get flocks of our kids to come out to you guys' events. And I started to have relationships, and we would try to get as many kids as we can come. 1 year, we had a lot of white kids come to one of our events. 1 year. The very next year, the elders of the white churches found out where the event actually was and literally told the kids they couldn't come. Literally the very next year. And this is not speculation on my behalf.
No, yeah.
There was a gentleman, what was his last name? It was my forgetter is working real good. His last name was Green. He was working in youth ministry back then.
You're not talking about Chris.
It might be Chris Green.
Okay.
And he called me and he said, man, I'm sorry, we can't come. I said, we can't come. They found out where it was and we can't come. But that's not a isolated incident.
Right.
I brought my kids to the Pepperdine lectures, not the lectures too. There was Thanksgiving.
Thanksgiving Youth Festival.
Youth Festival every year. And 1 year, this is when I was also a participant. I had to ask. There was only one black person that was allowed to do anything during that time. His name was Murray Isaac.
Oh, Murray. Yeah.
Murray Isaac. And me and Murray were friends, but he was the only black person. And I asked him, I said, I preach literally all over the country. I do youth stuff all over the country. You mean I can't do a prayer? Not a prayer? And I was, I could go on and on and on. These kind of prayers happened all the time.
Well, let me let both you and Dr. Winrow speak to this. What is it that we need to hear now as far as what are ideas, things that we can do to move past this? Because I'm going to take a great leap of faith and say there's nobody on this call that is saying, well, all that is appropriate. They're saying, oh, my goodness. But in many churches, there is a wall that says, that's a social issue. We can't, you know, that's a political thing. We're just here to tell people about Jesus. And clearly, Christ didn't feel that wall was there because he was constantly breaking down social and racial barriers. Let me go to you, Dr. Winrow. What practical suggestions, thoughts might you have about, as you say, a faith-based response to social unrest?
I think the first thing we need to do is have a clear understanding. It is during this time that we get calls. I know I get calls from, you know, our white brethren asking, you know, what is it, you know, that we need to know? What is it, you know, that we need to do? Mm-hmm. And this type of thing. One of the things, you know, is to have the conversation about white privilege, you know, what it really is. Sometimes brethren, because they may be isolated in communities, you know, that are outside the pain centers of society, don't realize how they may be even complicit, you know, with the problem, adding to the problem of systemic racism. Just like the situation that happened with the Rodney King jewelry, trial being moved to Simi Valley. And those people had no idea, you know, of how they were seeing things and how they were being actually complicit to the problem that are being experienced, you know, on the other side of town, you know, so mm-hmm. to speak. So there is a such thing that of white privilege, and many times whites don't see it as a problem. And that's what makes it a problem when you think something is not a problem because it's not a problem to you. You know, that's what privilege is, you know, and there are 2 ways to understand it. Let's just use 2 analogies. And that is white privilege is like swimming in a stream. You know, in one situation, you know, privilege means that you're swimming and struggling, but the current is carrying you forward. Mm-hmm. In other words, you're not swimming against the current.
Right.
You know, it doesn't mean that you're not trying hard. It doesn't mean that you're not working hard, but the stream itself is designed to move you forward. And the other, and of course, only certain blacks are privileged to swim in that particular stream. You know, but then there's that other stream, you know, where blacks are minorities, black and brown people, minorities are swimming, but they're swimming against the current. And if they ever stop struggling, the current itself is going to move them backwards. It's like when after 1965, you know, that became voter apathy. After 2008, you know, with the election of Obama, that was voter apathy. And what happened? You know, many of the gains that were lost, that was gained in 2008, you know, 2 years of grace, then happened 2010, you know, where the House and Senate was taking control and much of everything, every initiative was canceled from what Obama was putting forward. But the point is that the swimming in the stream is, you know, when everything is designed to actually move you backwards, even though you're struggling just as hard as those on the other side, you know, to move forward. Another analogy is the seesaw analogy. You know, in other words, you know, when you look at oppression and when you look at privilege, you know, with the seesaw analogy, that means if you are up, that just simply means somebody else is down. You know, so the point is, you know, that privilege is the bridge, you know, between personal prejudice and racism, in as much as all of us, as the scripture would say, we're sinners. We have biases. You know, we have implicit biases. You know, we have biases against people that may not look like us, walk like us. All of us, you know, all of us, because of sin and brokenness, we have these biases. But some people are privileged to invoke or to impose their biases and prejudices upon structures, upon systems. And that's what creates what we call systemic racism, you know. So they're able to impose those things that all of us have, but many of us are not privileged, you know, to deal with, to impose our prejudices and biases upon systems of governance and this type of thing. So we need to first, then secondly, we need to understand the nature of the problem. You know, many times people think the problem is people. The people are not the problem. Black people have been saying, you know, for years, black leaders have been saying that there's nothing wrong with black folk. You know, black folk are not the problem. The problem is two things, is power and policy. Mm. And power cannot be disembodied, because if you disembody power, then you enable it. In other words, you make it worse. Power represents those who have the privilege of making the laws, signing the laws, enforcing the laws, voting for the laws. You know, that's what power is all about.
Right.
And that problem exists on every level of government in our society. You know, when you talk about the local level, power is who becomes the district attorney, who becomes the mayor, who becomes the judges, you know, that has the power to put your kids in, who becomes the police officers, that has the power to execute, you know, in many ways. So the point is, on the state level, when you talk about power, state does three things. The state educates, it medicates, and it incarcerates. And when funds are allocated simply for incarceration, what happens to Medicare? What happens to education? You get the end results. You know, on the federal level, the federal government is responsible, has the onus of creating the system, the structure, where on every level of our lives, we have opportunities. You know, that's what it's all about. And so there has to be a fair distribution of power in order to solve the problems that we are encountering.
Well, let me ask one question right there. There is a group of folks watching this that have some power. We have, as ministers, we have the power of the microphone. We have the power of congregational leadership in different ways. What do you believe are the appropriate ways from a faith-based response that leaders in churches can step in to move the needle in a reconciliation, justice direction? I've got to believe it's got to be talking about this issue of privilege. And I love, somebody already texted in and said, I love the stream analogy. You're going to get quoted on that one. that's a picture people can get a hold of. Are there any resources or books or documentaries or things that you'd say, listen, if you got folks that have been living inside a white privilege bubble, here's a way to help them go, oh, I get it.
Well, let me tell you this, you know, because the cry of the streets is literally not just the cry, you know, for the community at large, it's also the cry for the church. There needs to be a renaissance. There needs to be a new birth. You know, there needs to be repentance. John the Baptist told the people that came to his baptism, you know, bring forth some fruit of repentance. When we talk about, you know, whites, we look at these demonstrations in the streets as black and white, you know. Yes. But let me tell you something, back in the civil rights movement, you know, when King was in Birmingham, whites in the North came down, you know, to Birmingham to be a part of that. What happened at Selma, whites came from the North to be a part of that. But notice when King went to Chicago, the very whites that were allies with him in Birmingham and in Selma because of the Bloody Sunday, those very whites protested against him in Chicago. And and in his speech, you know, that he made at Princeton, I think it was, or Yale, King talked about that. You know, what was the difference? And that is that the whites that were allies with the Southern movement, they were activated simply because of shame and embarrassment. They were activated by the cruelty of Bull O'Connor's. They were activated by the cruelty of the police, but they were not fully invested in the freedom struggle of black people. And I'm saying, so the first thing that we have to do in terms of looking at this from a faith-based perspective, because I think the principles of scripture give us all that we need, you know, in to create the proper dialogue and the proper response, you know, is to recognize that this is going to require total engagement, not to be activated because of the cruelty that happened to George Floyd, you know, or the cruelty that we're seeing, you know, but be activated because you recognize that you are either part of the problem or you're part of the solution. And you cannot, in this situation, you know, that there's no room to simply be a non-racist. You have to be anti-racist.
Yes.
You know, because the problem is a totally encompassing problem. And so whites have to demonstrate, you know, the ability to stop disappointing black people when it comes to the struggle for their freedom. And then let me just add this. We need to recognize that the normal response of whites to the issue of injustice, you know, which has been colorblindness. And let me tell you, that's an inadequate response, and it also adds to the problem. Many whites are teaching their children, you know, not to talk about race or not to see race. By the time they're 10 years old, you know, you don't look at people, you know, in terms of color and this type of thing. Well, let me tell you something. Colorblindness is a problem because when you don't see who I am, when you don't see my color, you don't see my discrimination, you know, and that's an issue, you know. So people have to learn to accept people for who they are, you know, and what their character is all about.
Wow. I'm seeing amen, amen, amen down there in the chat line. I just want to repeat a statement that you made. I had heard it prior to this, but I'm glad you said it, that color blindness is not an answer. It is a problem.
It is a problem.
Because it denies a part of the reality. Faith, jump in here. Your thoughts on as church leaders, what we need to be doing and thinking. And as I bring Faith over, I've got to recommend a book that impacted me called Stamped from the Beginning. Ibram X. Kendi, a wonderful history, and another book called Waking Up White, and I'll get both of those in the chat line. I'm sure there are other books and things that folks can tune into and listen to. I'm betting you've got some sermons online, Dr. Winrow, that could help people, but let me go over to Faith for a minute.
Well, I'll introduce one book. A friend of mine, his name is Dr. Amar Saheeli. He has a book, it's called An Eerie Silence. It's on Amazon and other platforms. Pick it up. He's a Church of Christ guy. So a lot of his analogies have to do with the church. But it's the subtitle is Race, Racism, Explored Across Educational, Theological, and Justice Continuums Amidst America and Beyond. So
hold that book up there one more time, Faith, so they can get the title and get this in the chat line. and that is Eerie Silence by Amar Sahili.
Sahili, yes. His dad was an elder at the Uptown Church of Christ there in San Francisco.
Oh, wow. Wow.
So anyway, I'll say a few things about what I think we ought to do. I'll start with what I did. I intentionally made sure that I tried to interface with people who did not look like me, to develop relationships with people who didn't look like me, to have friends. Many of my friends are on right now. I did that intentionally. I don't think you can have a ministry of reconciliation without doing so.
Yep.
But I am not naive. I also know that there is a power component that I am not in the power position to affect the level of change that needs to happen. You were saying about, and Dr. Winrow brought this up, about how people can ignore things. And I was disgusted the other day. I was listening to a preacher, happened to be a white guy, and he was preaching on the ills of the social gospel, the ills of the social gospel. And I said to myself as I listened to him, the only reason you can say that, only reason you can afford to say something like that is because you're white. When you're black, African American, whatever label you want to put on my people, you can't afford to think that way. You can't afford to have this huge dichotomy, this radical separation between the sacred and the secular. You can't afford to have a gospel that does not interface with people's pain, because every Sunday you're looking at people's pain. You just can't afford to have that kind of mamby-pamby, Pollyanna kind of look at life. So if you ask me what we should do, I should think we should remember a couple of things. First, remember the idea of catharsis is insidious. What I mean is this, is that when you see something is horrible, it touches your humanity. That's Blackwater anybody. And so when you watch George Floyd, or when you hear about what happened to Breonna Taylor, or when you see what happened to Ahmaud Arbery, or what happened to Botham, something in you, especially if you're a Christian, even the Spirit of God, it moves within you. The problem is it gives you a catharsis, and you start to feel like, oh man, this is terrible, this is horrible, and you feel like, I need to do something. The problem is catharsis is insidious, because it becomes a prize within itself, a reward within itself. I'm all right because I feel bad. And so I don't really have to do anything because I'm a good person because I feel bad about what happened. Second thing is that cost incentivizes or impedes. I believe the reason many of us don't interface, those who have power to do, is because of the cost. Because of the cost. The cost of doing what many of and I've had so many conversations with friends, white friends, of what they know they need to do, the cost is too huge. And I talk to mostly preachers. They literally say they'll be fired. Literally. So to do what they need to do for social justice, they would literally get fired. And so the cost becomes prohibitive. There's no incentive. There's no incentive there. So cost either incentivizes or impedes. And when the cost is that level, it's going to immediately stop most people. Most people aren't willing to be a martyr when they don't think that their martyrdom is going to save anybody and it's going to get them kicked out of their home. When you're talking about a kingdom response. I think a kingdom response, a church response, has to look beyond politics and beyond social types of divisions. What I mean is this. The churches of Christ are by and large demographically Republican. 90-some percent.
Wow.
90-something percent. The problem is, within the Church of Christ, you have a lot of African Americans, which are 80% Democrat. When you ask for things, the language of today has been so coded, and I hate it, that with white Republicans, anything that sounds like social justice ends up being conflated or at least redefined as liberalism. But the converse is true also. when black folk are talking, anything that's Republican starts to sound racist. Mm-hmm. I'm just being real. If it's Republican, it's racist. And our president does not help. You can be a Republican or not, but his rhetoric does not help. Mm-hmm. So I think a kingdom response has to start with us deciding, what are we? Are we about Jesus, or are we about our political stances? Because once it becomes about Jesus, it'll become about consecration, conversion, conviction. It'll start, then we'll have to move in what the Holy Spirit says, instead of having this hermeneutic, which makes us interpret scripture through the lens of our politics. And I actually think that's heresy and ungodly. But if you ask, I think we have got to move beyond that. Now, if you don't want to talk about practical things, I've said it publicly, I've said it in writings, I've said it constantly. The difference, if you're talking about the church, the difference between the resourcing of African-American Church of Christ and white Church of Christ, we're not even in the same neighborhood. We are so far apart. I mean, we are so far apart. I mean, we're ridiculously far apart. And I didn't know that. My friend Andy Wall is on now. And we were sitting down. I remember he was talking about, some stuff, and we started talking about money and financing of ministries. And I just started laughing. I started laughing at him. I wasn't laughing at him. It's just, it was so different. It was farcical. The struggles he was having of paying people, the people he was struggling paying were making almost twice as much as I make. I'm like, what? And that's your problem. Your problem is that you can't find, and I wasn't laughing at him. I just, this serendipitous light just went off in my mind. Like, dude, we are miles apart. And so when you talk about us coming together as kingdom, you talk about everything. You talk about community, communion, fellowship, koinonia.
Well, Faith, I'm sitting here writing some notes for myself, and I'm thinking, okay, you challenged me to say, I want to, and if you can come back to me on the speaker view, I don't know if that's there. I want to get out and intentionally, purposefully have times and coffees and lunches. And then I remember that when we reach out here at Pepperdine, I work in the Youth Leadership Initiative, we reach out to try and get youth ministers together. And when I contact youth ministers from black congregations, they'll often say, oh, when's your meeting? Oh, well, it's on this Thursday. You know, we're going to do this during the day. And they say, well, man, I work.
Absolutely.
And of course, I'm thinking, oh, well, I thought you work at the church. Well, no, the church can't afford that. I'm working here so that I can do God's work there. And I have to confess, I think there's a lot of us in ministry who would think, okay, well, I'll call up Brother Bob and see if I can, you know, get him to do a lunch or coffee. And he's going to say, well, it's going to have to be after work. Absolutely. So my prayer and my hope is that all of us, and I'm still on the speaker view, maybe I am, okay, that all of us can make a personal decision and commitment to, I'm not going to use the word strategically, I'm going to use the word Christianly, reach out to brothers and sisters of, well, I'll use your words, who are different from you, whether that's brown or black or Asian, but specifically right now in our communities, our black brothers and sisters are in a different position than several of the other minorities in our world right now. And historically, boy, we could just get into all this. Dr. Winrow, if people would like you, whether it's to come and say words for their congregation or to get some resources from you, what's the best way for them to reach out? By email?
Yeah, let me just comment just, you know, before we get away from this.
Do it.
I think, you know, when you talk about this, the church, you know, the church during this time, you know, need to be engaged in making itself what it ought to be, you know, a model of reconciliation. You know, the church today, churches of Christ today are more segregated than they were before the civil rights movement. You know, and I literally mean that. You know, one of the things that covers our inactivity as it relates to racial reconciliation, you know, is the postmodern era that brought in the concept of diversity. You know, and when we talk about diversity, you know, that is we pack our churches, or we put diverse faces in our churches and that type of thing, but it does not cover up, you know, the issue that these churches are totally socially unengaged, mm-hmm. you know, with the issues, you know, of the pain centers of community because of segregation. Mm-hmm. They are mm-hmm. unengaged. And so I'm saying that we need to rid the church, you know, of this black and white divide, mm-hmm. you know, just in terms of the schism of it. You know, that churches, regardless of whether you are affluent, whether you're sitting in an affluent area, it is your responsibility to be a voice for the voiceless, to be engaged in the struggle of liberation in the community. You know, and when we're not engaged, we're part of the problem. And so I'm saying we need to have a strategic commission, put together a commission, you know, in the church on social equity, equality, and justice, you know, inclusion, equity, and equality. We need to rid through a special strategic program or plan or commission any institutions related to the church. You know, this commission needs to have a strategic plan of helping these institutions to rid themselves, you know, of injustice, of inequity, you know, and this type of thing. And so we need to address the issue of this divide between that Faith was talking about between black and white and all this mm-hmm. stuff. And we have the ability through scripture to create the dialogue, you know, this polarization that takes place in the communication between civic republicanism and liberal democracy, you know, where the emphasis, say, in civic republicanism is on personal responsibility, the emphasis in liberal democracy, you know, has to do with structural changes and this type of thing. The conversation scripturally can be put together, because keep in mind, civil rights leaders took the vision, that very vision and symbol, you know, that mm-hmm. drove the civil rights movement, which was the vision of the beloved community. That comes right out of scripture. Amen. That comes right out of Ephesians 2, you know, a kingdom without second class citizenship. Mm-hmm. The very vision of the kingdom. Do you not know we have the identity, you know, as a religious tradition? You know, we have the wherewithal. We have a high view of the word of God. We have a high view of the family of God. The kingdom is the family of God, you know, mm-hmm. to actually be an instrument, a model for the community. But you can't model reconciliation without otherness. You know, you can't do it. You know, so long as you're isolated from what's going on in South Central Los Angeles, and you're not engaged with those churches in terms of what the struggle, you know, of minorities and black and brown people, if you're not experiencing the pain of what's going on, it's because you are isolated and segregated from that. And even you, and even the blacks that become a part of these congregations become socially irrelevant, you know, to the struggle that they experienced in growing up. And I'm just simply saying that we need to take advantage of this time, because what is being called for, the ask is huge. You know, it's huge. It's saying a new birth. You know, we need to construct a nation that is free of racism, where we can have policing just like that takes place out in Simi Valley, it takes place in our community. We just want the same kind of policing.
Amen.
You know, not being over-policed for the trivial stuff and the under-policed when people kill our relatives. So the point is that we need to address the issue of injustice, inequality, inequity, and that type of thing, and we need to have a strategic plan for it.
Amen. Amen. You know, one of the realities of growing up within the Churches of Christ is we always talked about how, because we are autonomous, you know, we're more biblical, and that autonomy language has at times driven us to be so segregated, separated, and lack the cross connections that even this simple time today, hopefully, has bred in some of us. So let me again thank Dr. Winrow, thank Faith.